Hi, I'm Barry Mitchell, and welcome to Simply Science. Well, it's February, and that means we observe Black History Month, when we celebrate the achievements African Americans have made to the USA. February is also American Heart Health Month, reminding us to take care of our tickers. Our Ari Goldberg has a story combining both.
February is American Heart Month, and of course, February is also Black History Month. So we'd like to take this opportunity to celebrate a woman who encompasses both, the late, great Marie Maynard Daly. She may not be a household name, but, well, to say nothing of racial or gender factors, certainly very few chemists exist in the public eye as household names regardless. But Daly was a pioneer, with accolades from the American Heart Association, New York Academy of Sciences, and American Cancer Society to show for it. Not only did her research contribute to advances in understanding muscles, cells, proteins, and yes, heart health, but she stands as the first Black woman in American history to earn a PhD in chemistry. Marie Maynard Daly was born right here in Queens in 1921, and would go on to graduate with honors from CUNY's own Queens College in 1942. Now, while 1940s America was not exactly a level playing field, this was during World War II, and with a nation mobilized for war, more opportunities were available for women and minorities than had been before. And indeed, someone as gifted as Daly wasted little time taking advantage of that window, enrolling in Columbia University and completing that groundbreaking PhD in 1947. Her work in the field would prove equally groundbreaking. Always interested in cellular chemistry, her research described how muscle cells best absorb creatine. And furthermore, her studies led to new understandings of cell proteins as well as DNA. In fact, when Watson and Crick won the Nobel Prize in 1962 for describing the structure of DNA, Watson cited one of Daly's research papers in his acceptance. And that brings us to the heart. If you know you're supposed to watch your cholesterol for your heart's health, you have Daly to thank. Her studies were the first to call attention to the role of cholesterol in clogged arteries, and also provided a lot of foundational research into our modern understanding of hypertension. By 1986, Daly had retired from research, but not from advocacy. Realizing the importance of her own journey, in 1988, she established a scholarship for African-American science students at her alma mater, Queens College. Marie Maynard Daly died at the age of 82 in 2003, but her legacy very visibly lives on, not just as a pioneer of Black scientists and heart health, but indeed quite tangibly as well, with the 2016 founding of the new PS360 back in her hometown of Queens, dedicated as the Dr. Marie M. Daly Academy of Excellence, a monument to a trailblazer and an inspiration for those to follow. For Simply Science, I'm Ari Goldberg.
For decades, we've been warned that saturated fats do a real number on our arteries. Well, here's a new reason to avoid them.
Eating a lot more while working from home? Watch out for those saturated fats. They can affect your concentration.
We found that a meal high in saturated fat can negatively impact your attention compared to a meal high in unsaturated fat.
Annalise Madison is a clinical psychologist at Ohio State University's Institute for Behavioral Medicine Research. She's also the lead author of a study published in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition.
We did a study with 51 women, and basically we were interested in the effect of a single high saturated fat meal on attention after the meal, and we compared that to a single meal high in unsaturated fat.
Participants ate a specially prepared meal high in dietary fat twice. The first contained highly saturated fat. A few weeks later, they ate the same meal made with sunflower oil, a high unsaturated fat. In each case, following the meal, participants took what's called a continuous performance test, with computer activities measuring their attention, concentration, and reaction time.
Women, after eating a single high saturated fat meal, were 11% less able to discriminate targets from non-targets on this computerized test.
Only women participated in this study.
But of course, more research is necessary to see if the results that we found are there also among men. So that's an interesting question for future research.
Remind us about good fat and bad fats.
It's related to the idea of good cholesterol and bad cholesterol. And so we really want to have more of these high density lipoproteins that are basically helping to clear cholesterol by escorting it to the liver, and that the liver is helping to clear that cholesterol. On the other hand, the bad type of cholesterol is actually building up in the arteries. And so the more that we eat saturated fatty acids, the more likely we are to have this arterial plaque buildup, which underlies artery diseases.
I asked, why do many of us crave saturated fats over healthier choices?
That's a really good point. And especially you might be finding that that's true during the COVID time period when we're all a little bit more anxious, we're all a little bit more stressed. We know what happens in response to stress is that there's hormonal changes in the body, and that could in fact be causing you to crave the pizza and the hot dogs and the hamburgers more so than the broccoli.
What would be a conclusion?
Fat is not necessarily the culprit here. We just need to be selective of what type of fat that we're consuming. What we choose to eat on a moment-to-moment, daily basis can affect our workplace productivity. And so this does have implications for our daily lives.
Video games and social media can be all-consuming for teenagers, especially during these stay-at-home months of the pandemic. Fortunately for parents, there's Dr. Delaney Rustin.
When I tried to stop him from playing the games, he turns into another person.
I gamed until like 1 in the morning, and then I gamed 3 in the morning, and then I gamed until 5 in the morning.
Normal development is very much allowing our kids to have plenty of time off of screens, and that's really hard, particularly now with COVID.
Dr. Delaney Rustin is a practicing primary care MD and creator of the documentaries Screenagers and Screenagers: The Next Chapter. Her new book is Parenting in the Screen Age.
Our technology revolution warrants a parenting revolution. We often hear people saying, well, I don't know how to parent this. I didn't grow up with it. The endless dopamine-creating TikTok videos that are geared to having that quick laughter feeling or awe feeling.
Sorry, sorry, I'm sorry, sorry.
Psych. The endless supply of new people and people they know contacting them and relating to them. It is so unlike anything we have ever dealt with.
Is it correct for us to say that screen time can be a real addiction?
Luckily, that's rare. And I don't like to use the word addiction for two main reasons. One, it's not clinical addiction. And two, we don't want our kids to think they're addicted and there's nothing they can do. And we don't want them to use it as an excuse. Anything we do all day long is impacting our brains. And I'm particularly concerned about young people whose brains are still in development until the mid-20s. It's the last organ in our body to fully develop. I'm particularly concerned about what's happening from screen time because of lack of sleep. How do we make sure they're getting sleep? Because to me, as a physician, that is one of the hardest and difficult challenges that not all parents understand.
How do you police kids' screen times when they know so much more about computers than we do? You know, they look at us and they laugh at us.
You can outsmart her easily. No offense. Yeah, Mom, it's really hard math thing.
Use their intelligence around technology as something that we value and want their help in. They get to feel like they matter. Sure, sometimes we're going to have rules they don't necessarily want, like one of the best one, technology out of the bedroom, but I want to work with them. What time do they think that should happen? Maybe on Saturday, they get technology all night long in their bedroom. Life is about boundaries and rules, and we're doing this out of a good reason, loving reason, and basically helping them to be tech wise and life balance. The other thing I want to say is just the other day, I was with my son and his girlfriend, and she was scrolling all the time. And I thought to myself, can we have a saying in our society? Do you mind if I scroll? Because I just wanted some acknowledgement that we were all together in the room. She was checked out, and it kills me on two levels. For one thing, I feel like I'm unimportant. And the second thing, I'm dying to know what she's looking at. And the other young people that call it, my son and one other person who's in his safe pod because of COVID, they weren't fazed by it at all. But I do think that some of us are more fazed than others, and that rather than saying, do you mind if I smoke, if we start to say, do you mind if I scroll, then we at least have a way of having that conversation, and we don't just default into our own silos in the presence of other people.
Or do you mind if I scroll while I'm smoking?
Oh no, as a physician, I'm not gonna allow that one.
This was fun, thank you.
Thank you so much, Barry. I really enjoyed it.
Fashion takes a lot of work. You think I just wake up looking like this? And into every gorgeous coat or gown goes hours of planning and sketching and geometry. Here's Lisa Beth Kovetz.
Science is an art form, you know, when it comes to fashion. The geometry aspect is the basic way to construct a garment.
Jean Rebel is a bespoke dressmaker, designing and building individual garments for high-end clients.
I was barely 6 or 7 years old. I was looking at a Paris match that had the wedding of Beatrice of Holland with Klaus. And I was fascinated as such a very young age, you know, by the beauty and, you know, the colors, you know, and the luxury, you know, of dressing.
And while the geometry of fashion has become second nature to this artist, it remains a very basic element to his design.
Geometry is more adapted to women when it comes to creating a pattern, because it has to do with shape and curve and precision. For men, it's created mathematically with lines of a neckline, shoulders, sleeve, body.
And some of the most luxurious dresses made today use a very specific geometry called the bias cut, creating garments that hang and move with extraordinary grace. So what is a bias cut?
If you hold a piece of fabric, so you have the grain lined vertically and horizontally. The world and the world goes up and down and then straight across. When you have to cut something on the bias, you have to go diagonal, you know, to cut the shape. It gave it that it flows with ease and lightness, so the movement appear to be more gracious to the viewer, to the people. So it makes it a more attractive way of movement.
When the bias cut was first introduced in the 1920s by French designer Madeleine Vionnet, the fashion world was astounded by her discovery, and the bias became the basis for 1930s haute couture. And Vionnet's nickname, the architect of fashion, can be applied to both her designs and to her revolutionary labor practices that included paid holidays and maternity leave for factory workers. And the bias cut is extraordinarily elegant, but back to geometry. It's not economical, as large pieces of fabric are wasted and therefore not often found in mass-produced garments. But as a bespoke designer, Rebelle can indulge in creating luxurious bias-cut garments for interested clients.
Mostly, I make one garment. You know, it's, which is not necessarily one of a kind, but, you know, that's how it's created, because my work is for private orders, you know, individual orders, you know, if you want to describe.
And one of those private clients wanted an early 20th century style cocoon coat that draped and moved in a very particular manner.
In order to interpret this piece of garment, I have to go to the geometric aspect of it to understand how the lines are created in order to arrive to the coat. To demonstrate, you know, the bias cut, you know, the side of the coat is cut on a diagonal line. So that gives you the soft drape of the fabric. It's they look like waves.
The inspiration for this particular coat started with the fabric. So what's it like to work daily with these beautiful materials?
If you love what you do, then you'll be a happy worker, because you know loving work, mostly for me, doesn't has to do with. With wealth. You know, it's a lot more satisfying, you know, to do something that you love at heart, because it's always exciting, no matter what.
This has been Lisa Beth Kovetz for Simply Science.
The seafloor off the coast of Long Island is like a flat, barren underwater desert. So, to entice marine life into calling it home, New York State created an artificial reef made up of, get this, the old Tappan Zee Bridge and a bunch of old rubble and scrap metal. Our Andrew Falzon has more.
This is the rusted deck of the tugboat Jane in September 2020, a 70-foot-long heap of scrap floating 3 nautical miles off Jones Beach State Park. It was put there on purpose by New York State to sink to the bottom of the Atlantic to become part of the state's expanding artificial reef program.
The reef program, from its history, was really sort of an accident, because during the World Wars and World War II in particular, steel ships sank. And then when they found out later on, well, they were loaded with fish.
Jim Gilmore is the director of the Marine Division of the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. He oversees the artificial reef program, which has 12 spots in the waters around Long Island.
How long does it take for the reef to become basically a viable ecosystem?
Well, believe it or not, it actually can be almost immediate. As soon as the material settles, any fish or organism that's looking for shelter will start occupying the reef right away. Generally, when you start getting into encrusting organisms and building up that ecosystem, that can take weeks to months. But we were actually surprised when we did the first deployment in 2018 at Shinnecock, that we put stuff in the summertime and we went out in the fall. And I was even shocked at how quickly it had colonized.
And the DEC uses a wide array of materials in order to create the artificial reefs, including chunks of the old Tappan Zee Bridge, decommissioned boats, and reused building materials, all of which have been cleaned and prepped for an eternity on the ocean floor, bringing much-needed habitat to an otherwise barren desert in the ocean.
For us, it's a reef. It sounds like for Mother Nature, it's a buffet.
In some respects, it is. If you look at a lot of the reefs where they are in the south shore of Long Island or even any of the, you know, off New Jersey, whatever, the bottom's relatively featureless. I mean, you've got, you know, it's a sandy bottom and it does have dips and valleys and things like that, but generally it's relatively flat. So organisms that are structure oriented don't have as much opportunity. So when you start putting these reefs in, you're actually diversifying the habitat. And then when you diversify the habitat, you diversify the number of types of species that you're getting, so it improves the ecosystem.
The goal of the program is to improve habitat for a variety of purposes. The state hopes the reef will make improvements in fish stock for recreational and commercial fisheries. Even Governor Cuomo hopes to go fishing there. The reefs will also improve recreational scuba diving for those brave enough to enter the chilly waters that often suffer from poor visibility. One such diver is Dr. Brad Peterson, associate professor at Stony Brook University.
What are the types of fish and species you would see there?
So most commonly when we go down on these reefs, we see cunner, black sea bass, tautog, we'll see porgies, lobster, and crabs. Sometimes I'll see cod, which is, you know, a rare thing, but an exciting thing to see them swimming around there.
But some of the reef's visitors are even more exciting than cod and recorded from an acoustic research tag.
We put one receiver down off of Shinnecock last year, and when we pulled it up, we were really excited to find that there was a particular animal that was tagged off of Massachusetts during a 60-minute segment. And so it was very fun and exciting to actually see this animal swimming around the artificial reefs of Shinnecock.
And big fish means big things for the reef.
The more large predators that you find in an area gives you insight into kind of the health of that system. And I find it very encouraging that we're finding these large predators on these structures as they're moving up and down the coast.
So whether you experience it from above or below, New York State's artificial reefs are helping New Yorkers reconnect with the water. I'm Andrew Falzon for Simply Science.
Next, we'll hear from two CUNY interns who did not let the pandemic stop them from getting the most out of their internship with the New York City Natural Areas Conservancy.
The Natural Areas Conservancy is a nonprofit organization. We work closely with the New York City Department of Parks and Recreation, and our goal is to restore and protect forests, wetlands, and grasslands. The CUNY internship program started in 2016, and it started as a field course at Brooklyn College.
So in 2019, I was on a crew with two other interns, and we went out into natural areas to do what we call rapid site assessment, which is we're given certain observation points in a specific natural area, and we'll have to navigate to the observation point, and we'll collect data that's gonna allow restoration crews to get a sense of what's going on out there.
In April, when we made the decision to hold the remote internship, we talked to our partners at New York City Parks and asked them, you know, basically for their ideas. We have all of this rapid site assessment data from 2018 and 2019, and they really wanted us to look at planted forests specifically.
Our main project was to create tear sheets that the New York City Parks Department could look at and get a quick idea of ecological conditions and vegetation health at a particular site.
We started off with images from 1924, 1951, 1996, 2008 and 2018, and we really took a close look at what the land was being used for and what was on the land in each of those years. So you might see what was a baseball field in 1924 become an open grassland in 1951 and then become a forest in 1996. After that, we transitioned into interpreting data from our rapid site analysis.
We were noting the species breakdown, so like how many species were invasive versus native, and also just showing which species were occupying the different layers.
With the information that the interns provided, land managers at the New York City Parks Department could look at which invasive species are on site and determine which ones they'll need to remove.
Midway through the internship, the Natural Areas Conservancy published with the New York Times an article about New Yorkers and their relationship with parks during the pandemic. So we wanted to support that research. And for 2 days, I was able to go out into the field and participate in a social assessment with the U.S. Forest Service.
G-Sun and I went up to Van Cortlandt Park and started asking people, what are your feelings about this park? What has COVID meant for you and your park use?
About 60% of the respondents said that their use of the park had increased since the stay-at-home orders started in March.
I think working online, there was the benefit of learning a lot of computer applications about how to analyze data to support a larger project that I wouldn't have gotten if I was just working out in the field.
We did still learn a lot, and I think we did still create something valuable.
And that's our show. Remember, you can always contact us at tv.cuny.edu and on Facebook and Instagram. I'm Barry Mitchell. Stay safe, stay warm, and we'll see you next time on Simply Science.